Okay. I'm sorry for the dark projector. But I will tell everything what I have written down, so even if you cannot read it very good, I will tell you. The idea of my talk or of the tool I have written is to make a typical desktop, Linux desktop, more secure without making it difficult to use. Security is always a thing that makes other things difficult, and I try to avoid that. Okay, and the motivation is that we have some programs on our desktop that have to process untrusted data or data from untrusted sources. And every piece of software has bugs, and that gives some attack vector to to your desktop. The program I am concentrating on is the browser, the internet browser, or the World Wide Web browser, and its helper applications. Not every helper application is in danger. For instance, if you have a PDF viewer and use it for viewing your own PDFs, then it's not a problem. But if you use it as a helper application in your internet browser, it will start process data from such untrusted sources, and if there's a bug in the PDF viewer, then it becomes dangerous. The same is valid for the email client and its help applications and similar software. But I'm concentrating here on the Firefox browser or the Eiswiesel browser. We have already some easy-to-use tools to get more privileges, like sudo. It's nice, easy to use. But we don't have any anti-sudo, a tool that just decreases any privileges on our system. And that's what the immunity is good for. It just decreases the privileges. I will start with a small demonstration. First, I will show immunity, how it looks like to the usual user. There's an entry in the start menu, and it just starts another instance of Eiswiesel. Please ignore the error message. It's something that's new on this laptop, and I didn't find the error yet. It's probably fixed in the next release. So it's just a web browser. It can do everything what you expect from a web browser, like opening the depconf page. All the plugins and helper applications will work, at least the kind of helper applications that I have tested so far. But there are some differences. If you're trying to open a file, you see it's the home directory is empty, and the reason for that is it's a different home directory in varlib. And if you just look around a little bit in our file system from the browser, you will see that you have a narrow file system. It's difficult to see. You don't even have the slash home directory or slash sbin and such things. And if you look at the device files, you see that you only have devnull and the ALSA devices. So that's how it looks like from the normal, for the normal user. If you look at it in more detail, I'm afraid that will become a little bit more difficult to read. The command is just immunity, and you can, like in sudo, just add any command that you want to execute, like ls, or you can even add options. So quite easy to use. If you don't add any command line arguments, it will just start a shell. And what you can see is that you have a new user ID. It's not Tivana, so, but another user and another group, and you don't have any supplementary groups anymore. That's what you see at first. If we check, have a look at our file system, we see that we have only a few top-level directories, that some of them belong to the to our shadow user and to the group. We have our own temp directory, so any temp file vulnerabilities won't be a big problem here. Yeah, I already showed the device files. Difficult to read, only some of them. And the, what's interesting is that all the devices belong to the user, so we don't need any supplementary groups to access all the devices. It's just a little bit easier. And what there are some other interesting things that don't work anymore, like ping. And there are two reasons why it does not work anymore. The first reason is that ping needs a certain capability to work, but all capabilities are locked down in the new process, so you cannot reacquire such capabilities. There's no way. That's why ping does not work, but it would still be a set user ID root binary. And if ping has a bug, we could get access to any files that belong to root only. That's why the file system gets remounted with the no SUID and no SGID option. So even the set user ID root binaries won't change the user ID anymore. That are two reasons why ping does not work. It's no set user ID root binary anymore, and capabilities are locked down. What's interesting, we can check the our mounts. That's quite a long list. What we can see in the let's check it. Okay. In the third line that a temp file system is mounted at a root file system. And all the several files and directory gets bind mounted from our normal system. Also, so if I make the same in the outside the container, I see only a few of a few file systems. And in our container, I have even less file systems, but a lot of bind mounts. And there's another difference. The proc file system is read-only mounted. Strictly speaking, Firefox does not need the proc file system, so we could just U-mount it, but some other tools like the non-free Flash plugin just crashes without a proc file system. So we need it at least as a read-only mount here, if you want to support such programs and plugins. Okay, that was a short demonstration. Yeah, we have a narrowed file system. It's not a change root environment, that's important. We call change root in the process of setting up the container, but it's not a change root environment. So on a more normal environment, so if you keep your system up to date with security fixes, then the container is secure too. So don't have a second system. almost every file system is that is still available is mounted read-only, no that user ID root, no that user ID and group ID, and no dev mounts, and the capabilities are locked down, so cannot get any capabilities anymore. It is still in a very early stage. It's, I would call it a research tool, but it can be used for real work or in real life. So you can use it for using your browser. That works. There might be some bugs, of course, but it's already usable. Yeah, you can download it from Google Code. The link should be available in the schedule. Some features I already mentioned is a shadow user and another group the shadow user belongs to. The name of the shadow user in this case is that the normal user gets prefixed by immunity minus.
Is this an extra user in the instance?
Yes.
So you have two user entities in your path ID.
Yes. The advantage is that no inter-process communications to your trusted processes are possible anymore, so you cannot kill or send signals to your trusted processes. The communication via the X11 protocol is still possible, of course. I don't use X11 security. I have tried that, but the advantage of X11 security is that key loggers wouldn't work anymore and screenshotting wouldn't work anymore. But copy and paste does not work between trusted and untrusted processes. And that's difficult. It's not easy to use if you cannot copy paste between trusted and untrusted processes. One could. Maybe I will write a helper tool like the, in KDE, the Clipper tool that can copy and paste even in an X11 security environment, but currently such a tool does not exist. You can set up some network restriction if you want using IP tables, NetFilter module that matches either the user or the group. So what's, it would be possible that your browser can access the internet, but maybe not your local intranet if you have such things, and vice versa, any trusted process should not access the internet, but maybe your local intranet. So you can even set up a network separation in your environment. How does it work? It employs the kernel namespaces feature. That comes from the Linux Containers project, which is available from SourceForge. It does not need any kernel patches, at least with the Lenny kernel. It's not necessary anymore. And thanks to the kernel team, the necessary configuration options are set in Debian. So you can use it directly without any different kernel, and you don't need any unusual tools, except for the immunity tool itself and Python. Yeah, some more details. You can create other access restrictions via POSIX access control list. For instance, you can set up your shadow home directory in a way that normal trusted user can access this home directory read-write if you want such a feature, for instance, to upload files somewhere. You need write access to the home directory. As I already told, we have only a few device files, so the path to the kernel is smaller And set user ID is set. Group ID binaries don't work anymore. And the proc file system is read-only. It is a bit difficult to find out which file system or network access is done by your programs. I have debugged such access using the audit daemon, which is a bit awkward to use, but it works. So you can find out which file system access happens in your browser, and which, for instance, you can find out that the which files in the proc file systems are accessed by the Flash plugin. So it's implemented in Python with a Z extension, which is quite small, just to use things like uMount directly in Python. It uses capabilities a lot, so it starts with a certain capability set, I think of 4 or 5 capabilities, and it drops the capabilities until the full container is set up and it executes your browser or your shell after every capability has been dropped. It's not a mandatory access control system like the security enhanced Linux system or SMAC or the RSBAZ system. It's just a usual Linux system without any special modification. Now I want to talk a little bit about what alternatives we would be possible or we could think of to separate trusted and untrusted processes. One alternative would be using a separate computer for untrusted processes. Of course, we have just 2 computers, one for the trusted stuff and one for the internet. That's okay, more hardware and setup costs. You have to maintain more systems, especially if you think about if you have hundreds or thousands of users and you have to care of twice as much computers, it's more work. And you can still exchange malware via some external storage media. A second alternative would be using a terminal server for your internet access or for your untrusted processes. That's quite a nice idea. But a secure configuration is not as easy, and it would be an extra talk to explain what you have to do to set up a secure terminal server. And it has several limitations in practice, like multimedia streaming, file uploads, and such things are either not possible or the whole thing is not really secure. So you can choose between security or functionality. The third alternative would be a short environment, a chain short environment. The security is quite limited because you can still make inter-process communications, you can send signals to your trusted processes. It's not as useful as it might sound. It's difficult to configure too. You have to do it manually. And you have still twice as much systems to maintain because you have to maintain your root environment too. You have a second system installed. The next 2 alternatives are mandatory access control systems like the RSBAZ. It's quite a good technology, but it's not integrated in the Linux kernel. You need another separate patch. It's not integrated into Debian. And the documentation is almost non-existent, so it becomes difficult to use if you don't have any experience with it. A second alternative for a Mac is security-enhanced Linux. Unfortunately, there is no usable policy for such a scenario, and setting up your own policy is quite difficult, so it's not an option either. Now I come back to Linux audit. I've already told it's a little bit awkward to use, but it's you need it if you make a narrow file system view. You need some way to debug which what your programs or processes are accessing, which network or sockets they are opening, and such things. I found that audit Linux audit is usable, but not as easy as you wish. You use the typical tools like audit control, audit search, and audit report to look what your processes are doing. I just skip the demonstration because yeah, it's not that interesting. Yeah, I've already told you that I'm using a lot of capability. POSIX capabilities to set up the container. New Linux kernels provide a feature called POSIX file capabilities. This is an interesting feature. It's an interesting feature because you can give some binaries certain capabilities during startup. Unfortunately, the whole feature does not work for any scripts, especially not for Python scripts. So it's unusable for any Python script, so I couldn't use that feature. It did work, interestingly, in the 2.6.24 kernel. It did work in the 2.6.24 kernel, which was, I think, the first kernel that introduced the POSIX file capabilities. But it definitely does not work anymore in the Lenny kernel or any Neo kernels. That is why the immunity tool needs another way to get capabilities. And it needs to use a sudo helper for that. So I found it's the most easy way to get capabilities to mount or remount stuff, to change the namespace and things. No, a sudo helper. It really uses a sudo helper to get, with a good sudo helper, it gets all capabilities, then it changes the user and the group and drops the capabilities that are not needed. So it's quite a safe way to use sudo in that case. One problem is that the process capabilities do not survive the exec system call. That means we cannot execute another binary, like mount or IP tables or such things, because we would just lose the process capabilities that are necessary for any privileged operations. Everything we have to do in Python directly or in the Z extensions that gets loaded into the Python interpreter. That's a bit tricky, but it's doable. The advantage is that we only have one process setting up the whole container, and in the end of the process, it executes your browser or the shell or whatever you want to execute. What plans I do have for the future? One is to make it more usable for the end user. And less a research tool only. One thing is that is providing a configuration file. Currently, everything is now done programmatically in the Python script. So if you want to bind mount more files or directory, you have to change the Python script. This is not very practical for the end user. I probably introduce some command line parameters like using secure X11 or not using secure X11, so you can decide for yourself if you want it or not. It might be useful to make the shadow user optional and don't switch to a different user. Maybe a helper tool for easier usage of the audit daemon would be quite good. So you can easier debug your processes. Uploading it to Debian if there is enough interest in the tool would be a plan. And I have two ideas that could be useful. These two ideas are adding to another namespaces, a new net and its own network namespace and its own process namespace, process table. I will show that in a small demonstration. So I hope I'll start with the network namespace. It's currently not really implemented. I have only have two C files that for testing purposes. But it's already interesting. The network namespace. I've tried to explain it on the source code. What it does, it's just call the unshare syscall with the new net namespace. Unshare is quite a new system call. It does almost the same as clone, except it does not clone anything. It just changes. It just uses the flex in the currently in the current process. In this case, it just creates a new namespace in the current process, and after that, it just executes a shell. So I show it. The unshare syscall sometimes need capabilities, like in this case, if you create new namespaces, you need certain capabilities. That is why I just use sudo in this case to execute this program. So we just have a root shell now with a new namespace, and if I call ifconfig, I see that I only have one network device, the loopback device, and it's not even configured. If I can compare it to my usual system, here I have three or four network devices, and loopback is configured, of course. So I have effectively now a container which is offline. It does not have a network access. It has its own network devices, its own routing tables, its own net filter rules. Currently, it's offline, which is not very useful to run a browser in it. But the idea is to create a proxy, like a SOX proxy, like the SSH minus D way. That would enable some network access to the container, but this is left to be implemented now. But I think it's quite a nice idea to have a separated network namespace. So it was a network namespace, and another interesting idea is a separated process namespace. I try to explain it in the C code. In this case, we cannot use unshare anymore because it's not possible to create a new process namespace in the same process. You always have to create a new process to create and attach a new namespace to it. That's why we need to call clone in this case. We have to set up a stack, call clone with a new process ID option and the new namespace option. And we print, in this case, just for debugging purposes, I print the process ID of the child as seen in the parent process. And the function that's executed in the child prints its own process ID, how it is seen from the child. In our case, we are U-mounting the proc file system, because it's in use, we have to add the mount detach option. And we mount it again, so we get a new proc file system mount in the child. And in the end, we are executing the X-terminal emulator. We cannot execute a bash in this case, but it's difficult to explain. We're just executing the X-terminal emulator. And let's try that. We need sudo 2 for this test. So first we see the process ID as seen from the parent is 2784, and the process ID in the child is 1. So, we have a new process table with a new process one. And I will just make it easier to see. Okay, so that's the child process. When we look at our process here, we see we have only three processes. Process number one is our X-terminal emulator, which has more than 2,000 as a processor ID in the usual system. Our shell is process number three, and interestingly, our first interactive program is process number 31. So we need more than 30 processes just to execute PS. And this is a normal or a usual installed Lenny system. So we have quite a number of forks during startup of a bash in Debian. The advantage is that from this child process, you cannot kill or send signals to any process outside the container. So you already have a separation of the processes. And this might be possible to skip the creation of a shadow user because we already have a separate process table. But it's currently not usable in Immunity itself. It's probably not very difficult to implement, but it's not implemented yet. Yeah, it's all told. It would make the shadow user probably optional. Okay, I'm at the end of my talk. Do you have any questions? This probably, yeah?
Okay, I will start with the X setup. Does the current mode mean that you can still collect my keys from my keypad while the program is started?
Yes, as long as it's switched off, is X11 security is switched off, it would be possible to install a keyboard locker via any bug in the browser.
Okay, second question, sometimes I want to have, let's say, distinct secure processes.
Now it works, but it seems to work a bit. Sometimes I want to have separate distinct secure processes. For example, I have some online, on my web browser, and I have my online banking via web browser. And of course, the online banking browser still isn't really trusted because it's still in a shitty ICE, whatever. Definitely, this information I enter there shouldn't be mixed up with information I enter on some other YouTube website or whatever.
Yeah.
So can that work, or can I set up more than one user? Or
yeah, currently not. It's probably a good idea to set up multiple users or multiple home directories. It's currently not implemented. Yes, but that would be probably one of the command line arguments to specify another user and just use a default user if you don't specify anything. Yes, that's a good idea. Okay.
Just a very quick comment. Your list of alternative approaches, you didn't mention using a virtual machine, and so, you know, I mean, KVM might be useful as an approach.
Yes, that's another idea. Yeah, I have skipped that here. But we have still maintained another system. But it's quite easy to set up. That's true. So it has advantages and its disadvantages. But it's not as easy to set up than just call Immunity browser. The idea was to create a tool that is really easy to use for the end user and has some more, it's more secure than not using it.
Right.
I've got a lot of questions. I'll try to keep it short. The first thing that comes to mind for me is you also have problems with X, not only if close the keyboard snooping type of holes, but you can also spoof things that look like authentication dialogues on these trusted side of the system, and that's going to be really hard to block unless you put it in something like XNest or something like that, which I guess would slow down YouTube videos. So I don't know what. Another thing that came to mind is, with this system, if a user downloads a file from the web and then wants to edit it in a word processor on their trusted side, they're going to have to go dig around to find the file, and they probably won't be able to write to it once they find it. So if you thought about how to deal with that, and also how to get files back in to and make it easy for, say, my mom to do.
Yeah, in such case, either you skip the shadow user entirely and use the normal user process and write the file in your home directory, or use some helper applications, I don't know, or just create a symlink in your home directory to the home directory of the shadow user.
So you still can't write to the file, so you need to have some kind of a helper app to.
Yeah.
Well, if you've got personal groups like you have in Debian, you could put your real user in the immunity user's personal group. Yeah. And then your real user can read and write all their files and be, you know, tricked by symlink exploits and everything.
And one more thing, I saw that you gave the browser access to the audio device, so the browser will be able to also listen to your mic, right?
Yeah, sure. Okay. If it's I don't think it's such a big security bug. Okay. Thank you for your interest. Have fun.